On the agenda tonight, we're going back to 1988. We're going to be taking a look at Freddie Mercury and Montserrat Caballé, and they're going to be performing Barcelona. Hello, Phil here from Wings of Pegasus, and welcome to another analysis video. If you enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. So this is the first opportunity I've had to look at Freddie Mercury's vocals, but also compare them with a classical singer. And something I mentioned in so many other videos about the classical techniques and how dramatic they are when compared with a more mainstream pop and rock vocal, they do vary quite dramatically. But we are going to be taking a look at that. I am going to be jumping into the video about halfway through and also throughout the end of the video during the analysis. So if you guys want to watch it the whole way through without me interrupting it, the link to this video is going to be in the description below, so you guys can click on that. And I have already done a dummy run to see if this got blocked on copyrights, and it didn't the first time I did it. So hopefully this will be okay. We'll get Freddie and Montserrat up on screen and see how they get on.
Bells are ringing out, they're calling us to
I'm just going to jump in here. This is such a difficult one to interrupt. I did say that I'd get to about halfway, but we got a little bit further than that. Something to mention straight away is that this is labeled as a live video, but it's definitely not live, and I'm sure you guys already spotted that. In the intro, where we have the choir singing, that is obviously Freddie Mercury's voice, multi-tracked, because it is unmistakable. And when we do get through the intro, I just want to draw your attention to some of the things that are going on with the orchestra, with the composition, because it takes you on a journey and it stirs up emotions within you musically just by the way it's been put together. And I want to point out a few things about it. So the first thing is the crescendo that we have in the intro. And this is when you go to a really open sound dynamically and you reach the top of your mountain where all the instruments are getting involved in the orchestra. So I want you to listen out to this ascension we have to the crescendo, to that really open place dynamically, and then what happens after. But let's have a listen. And there we have it. So that sounds like an ending. And I think if you heard this in isolation, you would assume that this came right at the end of a composition and that was the big finish, because that was the crescendo. That was the peak of the mountain that we have just reached. Whereas it isn't. It's in the intro and it's just a little focal point. The main thing to mention here is that by the end of this run that we go through, we resolve to E flat, which means that we go back to home base. The chords go around in a circle and then finish where they started. So it feels like you've come home to where you started and you've now had that crescendo as well. So it sounds like the end. I'm just going to let the video play on for a few more seconds to see where we go from the peak of that mountain and what follows. And then I'm going to stop it again and explain a few things. And I'm jumping in here because the dynamic was brought down. We had the sound of bells and church bells. So those were the only things that we were hearing. But now we've just had this dum da la dum da la dum da la dum da da da. And it almost sounds like Star Wars or a movie soundtrack because it's high energy. We've got a lot of accents and the whole orchestra all kicking off on these accents. So this cannot continue because there's too much excitement. You don't want to be getting into something that is high energy. For example, the Star Wars theme is high energy because you've got spaceships flying around all over the place and guns going off. You don't want this when you're about to get into a song. You want to bring down the dynamic before the vocals come in. So I'm just going to let this play on so we can see how it plays out. And you hear that, the instant drop to strings, and now we're in a place that is totally different to where we just were dynamically, because this is setting up the verse. By the time we get to the verse, it's just going to be Freddie with his voice and a piano in the background. So that journey from the peak of the mountain, we then went down to nothing, we then jumped right back up again, and now we're slowly coming back down again for the beginning of the verse, which means that we've now got this journey we can go on to the chorus. And we're at the bottom of the mountain for the verse. That's the point. Dynamically, that's what's going on. So it's making the journey out of the song to take you back up to that peak for the chorus. And you always want to leave people at the peak in the chorus, because there's no point in hitting the high point in the verse and then having the chorus on a bit of a downer, because that kind of song will never catch on, because everyone wants to be lifted up for the chorus. I'm not going to get really deep into the orchestral elements here, but just to maybe give you guys an insight as to how it works, how it's been put together, and how the dynamics make all the difference to every single composition. Thank you.
had this perfect dream.
So now here we are with just the piano. And just before it starts up, we're almost in silence. That is how dramatic these changes are. And that is the kind of thing you're always going to get in classical music. You very rarely listen to a piece of classical music that is just all out dynamically the whole time. And for the whole 8 or 10 or 15 minutes, however long the piece is, it's just blasted at you the whole time and then it finishes. That never happens. There's always a dynamic journey in classical music. But let's get into the vocal analysis and have a look at how the vocal stylizations differ from classical music to hard rock, rock, just mainstream pop. I know that Freddie will be seen as the top rock singer of all time, or one of the top rock singers of all time, but you can also throw in hard rock and pop. He could turn his vocal cords to anything, and this is a great example of that. But we are going to watch a passage of this performance, and we're going to listen to it just at normal speed the first time through, and then we're going to revisit it, slow it down, so that I can point out a few things. But let's have a listen. We have it. As we build up and we're just about to get into the chorus, as you can probably start to feel with the way that the dynamics are opening, but with Freddie and Montserrat as well, their vocals blend so well together, but they are totally different. And I'm going to rewind it back to the beginning of this passage just to point out a few things. So let's have another listen. Just that first line from Freddie there, he's tailing off at the end of that line, which you get in R&B and blues and soul and gospel music and pop, rock. It's something that the great singers tail off at the end of their lines sometimes instead of holding and applying vibrato. So the way that Freddie sings, "The bells are ringing out," that line there, "out," there's actually two or three extra notes at the end there, and then he cuts off that vocal phrase, and it's something that you don't get in classical music. Pretty much every classical singer will be singing notes for a long time. They'll be holding their notes. They'll never throw in a little bluesy line at the end of their vocal phrase. They will hold that vocal and apply vibrato, as we are about to hear. See there, you heard that vocal phrase, but before the phrase ended, Montserrat applied a little bit of vibrato at the end and didn't just purely cut off. For the drama of classical music and classical performance, when you go to the opera and you watch a classical singer, it's about the drama, it's about the whole show that they're putting on and the story. So there's always that extra little bit of vibrato thrown in there. Another thing I want to show you guys is something that I refer to all the time about the difference in pitch that is covered with the vibrato in classical music when compared with mainstream pop. And artists that sing in the mainstream don't cover a wide range pitch-wise. But we're going to listen to this, and I assure you that I have not edited this in any way apart from just playing it back at half speed. Let's have a listen. And there we have it. And I bet you cannot believe that that's what we're actually hearing. When it's sped up and the frequency of that vibrato increases, your brain doesn't take in the notes that Montserrat is covering here. But you can hear how wide that is going way up there in pitch. And if you're imagining seeing the pitch as a wave, it is all over the place. Whereas Freddie Mercury's vibrato is a lot more subtle, and it's almost within the note. He's not covering a massive range with his vibrato, and he has one of those types of vibrato that I would call natural. He's not trying to put it on. He hasn't learned to do it after the fact. Once he's learned to hit pitches, it's just part of his voice. Okay, we're going to go slow motion again, because this video is gold for showing the difference between the stylization of vibrato in classical and more mainstream singers, because here we get a direct comparison between Freddie's vocal and Montserrat's vocal, because they're singing the same notes an octave apart, but you can hear exactly how it differs, with Freddie's vibrato being faster and covering less of a pitch range, and then Montserrat's vocal, how much slower her vibrato is and how much of a range she covers. Let's have a listen. So there we have it. You could hear Freddie there with his very subtle and really even frequency. But as Montserrat continues that vocal, and then we just hear her finishing off that phrase, you can start to hear that change in frequency, how much slower it is, but also how much pitch is covered. So when she's going, she's really going up there. Obviously, I'm not a soprano singer and I'm not female, so it doesn't sound exactly like that. But you can start to get an appreciation of how much the difference is, how dramatic it is between Freddie's vibrato and Montserrat's vibrato. I just want to let the video play through into the chorus so you guys can start to get an appreciation of the dynamic change that we go through, because it's then all out. And there we have it. That was a male tenor high C there from Freddie Mercury belting it out in chest voice. And it's interesting, because when I was reading up on the song and the performance, it's something that was mentioned about this being a song where Freddie's singing in his baritone range and he doesn't get into his famous tenor range that he had. But this chorus is in the male tenor range. I mean, that is a C5. That's the holy grail in classical music, and Freddie's hitting this in chest voice. He is belting it out. So he's hitting a note that every male tenor in classical music wants to hit, a full-bodied C5. And that's exactly what we've got from Freddie here. So I think it is a little bit of misrepresentation the way that this song is described, because any guys at home trying to sing this would struggle, because that is way up there, especially belting it with this kind of feeling and effort that Freddie's putting in. I don't think anybody would question this note, especially in the chorus, as not being classic Freddie Mercury. I want to jump into another bit of slow motion here, just because it's a great example of the difference in drama, or perceived drama, between the classical voice and the more mainstream voice. So let's have a little listen to this. And there we have it. So you can hear that both Freddie and Montserrat at the end of that vocal phrase lean into it a little bit, but you'll notice how Montserrat vocal takes over because of the drama of the vibrato and the subtlety of Freddie's vibrato. And it's just a great way to show you guys the difference between the two voices. Like I said, it is so rare to have an example that you can show like this, where you have got two totally different voices working so well together using totally different applications of the same technique. Again, we're going to go slow motion. Like I've already said, this video is a goldmine for demonstrating the difference and being able to hear the difference, especially in slow motion. But in this example, Freddie does apply a tiny bit more of a pitch variation to his vibrato. But again, I'm going to say that I'm not editing this in any way. Have a little listen to Montserrat's vibrato after Freddie's. And there we have it. Such a great example of classical vibrato, great technique, and the range that is covered pitch-wise. When you slow it down, it blows you away with the technique that's being performed here by Montserrat. I don't want this video to go on for too long tonight, but I'm going to give you one more example. And this is going to be of Freddie Mercury's pitch, his accuracy, but also the way that his vibrato is within his pitch accuracy. So it means that he's singing these notes, hitting them dead between the eyes, but with his personality intertwined with his sound. And that's what it's all about, singing in key, on pitch, but with personality. And that's definitely something that Freddie Mercury had. Also, listen to Montserrat's vocal after Freddie's and her vibrato, because she's covering more than a semitone here. And there we have it. I'm just thinking of all of you guys watching this video, thinking that I've done something to it, that I'm changing it somehow, but I swear that I am not. This is classical vibrato. But before we finish, just to give a little bit of background on this performance, because it was in 1988, and you might have seen the Barcelona 92 and the Olympic logo there in the background. And this was one of the songs that was written for the Olympics, and they knew that it was going to take place in Barcelona in 1988. So they had a competition, or at least different artists and musicians who had put together a song for the Olympics in 4 years. And that's what this performance was all part of, very much showing it to everybody and whether it would be considered for the Barcelona theme or the song to represent the games. So that is why it is being performed in 1988. But it is such a great song to demonstrate this world of difference between one singer and another singer singing with different backgrounds, but singing together really well, in harmony with each other, working so well together, applying techniques in a totally different way from one another. Anyway, thank you guys for suggesting this video for me to take a look at, and keep those suggestions coming in the comments below. Let me know what you guys think, and if you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe, and I'll see you guys at the next one. Rock!